Good morning, everybody. I want to begin. I'm a very proud, strong Yorta Yorta and Tja Tja Rung woman, and I'm deeply committed to and advocate for the rights of my people. Today, I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land, the Wurundjeri people and the Kulin Nation and the Bunurong people. I would like to pay my respects to their elders past and present and to all Aboriginal people here in the room and listening. I think today it's important to acknowledge and thank the Speaker and Presiding Officer, the Premier of Victoria, the Honourable Daniel Andrews. Thank you for the invitation. The Opposition Leader, the Honourable Matthew Guy, the Minister for Prevention of Family Violence, the Honourable Fiona Richardson, the Shadow Minister, the Honourable Georgie Crozier, and all Honourable Members here today. Yesterday, we know, was International Day of Elimination of Violence Against Women, and today, I want to ask you to reflect on violence perpetrated against our Aboriginal women here in Victoria. I do work for the Victorian Aboriginal Child Care Agency, and what drives me and what drives all of our staff, our carers and volunteers, is the desire that all Aboriginal children are safe, that they are safe physically, emotionally and culturally. From this perspective, I would like to acknowledge Rosie Batty, an amazing woman, and for your story this morning. I think it's amazing to hear and tragic. Rosie is a survivor of family violence. Sadly, Luke Batty did not survive. We must never forget children in any of our approaches to family violence. I would like to thank Rosie and her active role as Australian of the Year and other campaigners, organisations such as Our Watch, White Ribbon and Rose, just to name a few. I'd like to acknowledge the government itself in announcing the Royal Commission and for the first time having a Minister for the Prevention of Violence. All this has led to an increased awareness and understanding within the community of the extent and impact of family violence in Australia. I would like to acknowledge and thank the Indigenous Family Violence Regional Action Groups, our Aboriginal people that work on the ground to look at and address family violence. To Aboriginal Affairs Victoria, the Department of Human Services. They've done a lot of work on Indigenous family violence in addressing Aboriginal family violence. Family violence impacts on Aboriginal people in vastly disproportionate rates and has devastating impacts. Aboriginal women are 30 times more likely to be hospitalised from family violence and almost 11 times more likely to be killed as a result of a violent assault. Family violence has significant, far-reaching and multiple impacts on Aboriginal people, especially women and children. We know that 80% of Aboriginal children in care come into care because of family violence, 80%. In our services, we see multi-generational impacts of family violence, especially the link between family violence and child protection. Family violence is a leading contributor to women's homelessness, poverty, criminalisation, incarceration, mental health and physical ill health and drug and alcohol abuse. We therefore cannot think of family violence in isolation. Our work at BACA in supporting survivors of institutional child sexual abuse is a stark reminder of this. Among the survivors we have supported, almost all men sexually abused have gone on to perpetrate family violence, and almost all women sexually abused have acknowledged being victims of family violence. So this leads us to the question, why? Why today in 2015 are Aboriginal women so much more likely to experience family violence than non-Aboriginal women? I would contend that the causes of family violence in Aboriginal communities has much of its origins in the treatment of Aboriginal people, in the treatment of our people through the process of colonisation of this country. The ongoing impact of racism, discrimination, bullying and stereotyping that Aboriginal people experience on a daily basis also contributes to family violence. In the faces of these daily experiences, Aboriginal people often feel ashamed, humiliated, fearful and experience a sense of powerlessness and hopelessness. In the Aboriginal community, family violence is as well as being understood as a feature of gender and structural power inequality between the genders, is also seen as a result of the impact of colonisation, the loss of traditional male roles, the forcible removal, relocation and separation of families, loss of cultural identity, and the dominant cultural impositions that have been placed on Aboriginal people. They all contribute to the situation we have today. These factors have led to a myriad of social and economic problems that the Aboriginal community faces and this government deals with every day. The current pervasiveness of loss and grief within Aboriginal community and its impact on children and families creates an environment where there is a high degree of trauma, and trauma is the norm. For a minority but significant number of Aboriginal women and children, this has resulted in family violence. Aboriginal community play a pivotal role in holding perpetrators accountable, and our communities now and leaders are standing up to family violence. We have given voice to the fact that family violence is unacceptable and not a cultural norm. To ensure the safety of all Aboriginal women and children, we do, though, however, need mainstream services to be culturally relevant, to engage with our people, not to let our people be short episodic contacts with the system. We need investment and resourcing of Aboriginal organisations to provide culturally relevant services to Aboriginal women, children, men, and to provide healing for our communities impacted by family violence. We need integrated, holistic, and intergenerational responses. We need culturally relevant services that are strength-based and trauma-informed. A major gap in policy and advocacy is the absence of our own statewide Aboriginal Women's Advocacy, Policy and Service Hub, a place where Aboriginal women can get access to culturally appropriate resources. It is important that we work earlier with Aboriginal women to provide relationship counselling, education and support, and we provide the awareness and strength to be able to ensure that our Aboriginal culture is part of the way we go forward, and we emphasise the important role that Aboriginal women play in our communities. But to achieve real change, we need to start by addressing poverty. And this includes poverty of money, poverty of access, poverty of power, and poverty of relationships. When you don't have these, you're more at risk of violence. Any reform agenda must include improving access and ensuring equity and integration to a responsive service. We also need to address the culture of violence against women. There is still acceptance of violence in our Australian community and our culture that contributes to violence in the family. Still too many Australians think, hit your wife, and this is seen as private, that it's their business and therefore acceptable. Hit a stranger, and now this is a danger to society, and we call the police, and now we have much harsher penalties before the court. Ever since television has found its way into our living rooms, the great powers be who choose what is played and what is not have played, whether deliberate or not, have portrayed Aboriginal people negatively. The dominant ideology of this powerful minority has shaped the public's perception of Aboriginal people in many harmful and deliberate ways. It is important that we challenge this ideology that creates negative and derogatory images, particularly of Aboriginal women, when it impacts on our women's capacity to live safely in this country. We need to reverse this. We need positive imagery on our TV screens and elsewhere of Aboriginal people. So today, I personally, as CEO of ACCA, would like to commend the Andrews government in its commitment to implementing all recommendations made by the Royal Commission. In announcing this Royal Commission, the Premier stated there will be a big price tag around the implementation of these recommendations. But Victoria's women and children are worth every cent. I would like to see that Aboriginal women and children are included in this sentiment to build on this commitment to Aboriginal people and Aboriginal self-determination. I would like to thank Minister Richardson for the opportunity to address Parliament today. I see this as symbolic of the strong emphasis you place on the place of Aboriginal people and Aboriginal family violence. I want to thank the Victorian Government and the Minister for Aboriginal Affairs, the Honourable Natalie Hutchins, for the putting to the Government and taking up the flying of the Aboriginal flag. How safe is this for Aboriginal people now? We know genuinely that this is our place. In conclusion, I would like to highlight that Aboriginal women are the hope of our future, the hope of our culture. It's Aboriginal women that are going to be the child rearers of our future generations. Aboriginal women are making visible efforts to renew traditions and to improve education through self-rule and by healing from within our culture. It is important to ensure that Aboriginal girls are strengthened and empowered to make good decisions into the future, that they see themselves as positive contributors to the directions their lives take. We need to strengthen our approach to family violence against Aboriginal women with a focus on prevention, protection, empowerment. I thank you for the opportunity to present here today. It has been an absolute honour, but leaving here today, I implore you and I implore the government to bring about real change for Aboriginal women now and into the future. Thank you.